Greetings and welcome to the Badger Cave's West Wing, where our stealthy polecats ferret out the best feels, funnies, and what the fucks to discuss slam bam badger style. Your sinuous hosts for this evening are myself, Supreme Doge in Charge, our polecat punster Hannah, Dr. Random McCann, Panda at Large, Max, Simpsons Kin, not jaundiced, and our anchorilla, Scott. This evening we'll be covering the following topics. A shocking twist makes us all ask who really killed Tiziana Cantoni. Earlier this year, feminist Jodi Allard wrote about one of her sons being suicidal. Then in September, she followed up with how her sons don't respect her feminist beliefs about rape culture. Is there a connection? We've all waited with bated breath for Nottingham's catcall hate crime statistics to be revealed, and now they have been. In an elegant meme-nouver, Trump trolls CNN by tricking them into covering a Trump supporter rally fairly. In an article that could be a transcript from a Honey Badger radio show, Oxford student Eleanor Sharman explains how embracing feminism was not unlike internalizing Sharia law, leading her to curtail her outside activities and dress modestly out of fear of men. Could this be the key to explaining the unholy affinity between Islam and feminism? New research suggests intelligence is inherited from the mother. No, seriously. And finally, our bonus story for the patron-only after show. Three reasons it's irrational to demand rationalism in social justice activism. All right, wait. Let me read that again for those of you in the back that didn't hear very clearly. Three reasons it's irrational to demand rationalism in social justice activism. Yes. You heard me correctly. Any way you want to listen to this topic or enjoy further personalized discussion with the Badgers on select topics, become a patron. www.patreon.com/honeybadgerradio. Now, we will begin with Scott with the news.
Woohoo!
Mr. Scott,
it's
would
me.
You tell us about Tiziana Cantoni. Tiziana Cantoni.
I will. I would be happy to do so. Any loss of life is tragic, even more so if the cause of death was suicide. Tiziana Cantoni's case is no different. After a leaked sex tape went viral, Cantoni changed her name, quit her job, moved from her house, and began fighting to have the footage removed from the internet. Sadly, though, the ordeal proved too much for her, and on September 13th, she took her own life. Cantoni's family vows to seek justice for the daughter's death, urging the authorities to act so that her death was not in vain. Currently, there are four people under investigation over alleged defamation of Cantoni. It seems that justice may soon be served It seems justice may soon be served until you hear...
Okay, you realize, I guess it's an error on the part of our guy.
Yeah, there's a here where there shouldn't be. Until you realize that there's one piece of the puzzle missing. Tiziana Cantoni was the one that leaked her own sex tape to several friends. It was done by her in an attempt to make her ex-boyfriend jealous. Unfortunately for her, her plan backfired and led to the chain of events that ultimately culminated with her suicide. Knowing that last piece of the story, one must wonder who is responsible for Tiziana Cantone's death after, other than Cantone herself. And my poor reading skills.
No, we got through it. We got through it.
Sorry.
So the short version is a woman named Tiziana Cantoni made a sex tape. It was like revenge porn, I think, to get back at her husband. And then he just put it on the internet. And then when he did, everyone was able to see it. And she was so ashamed of what had happened that she committed suicide. Essentially making her, not that, I don't know whether this was the intention or not, but doing that actually makes you best victim ever. Because how do you come back from that? Like, what do you say? It is a tragedy that it happened, but you have to look at all the choices that were made that led up to this moment. And, I don't know. It's pretty crazy. Does anybody have any, like, short thoughts on this?
Yeah, as callous as it may seem, this seems pretty cut and dry. I mean, it is awful what happened, but like you said, she's the one that instigated this whole thing, so it's kind of hard to... I don't want to say it's hard to defend her, but it's, she made her bed to a certain extent, I guess. I mean,
she's an hero, man. She did what it takes to be an hero.
Yeah, there you go.
That's a very dank meme for anyone.
Yeah. Yeah, Jax asks, revenge porn, question mark. Yeah, I mean, basically, she made a sex tape and sent it to her husband to, I guess, to upset him. You know, be like, this is me sleeping with another man. But instead of getting all butthurt about it, he probably was, but his reaction was, he was like, well, I guess I'll just share this with everybody. And so he put it on the internet for public consumption. Right. And that was something that she did not expect, apparently. And it really upset her, and so she took her own life. Yeah, she was sent it to her to humiliate him. I guess maybe revenge porn is not quite the right... I don't know, is revenge porn only when you go and find other people's nudes and then put them on the internet? Or is it? Can you also call it revenge porn when you like have sex with somebody else and then send it to your significant other? Like, I could just be using the wrong terms.
Revenge porn is when you post your ex's nudes or sex tape or whatever online to make public something that was supposed to be private, and you know, or even pictures that they didn't know that you took or things like that. That's revenge porn, and it's sort of been expanded now because there's been instances where women have posted their boyfriend's pictures of exes or whatever as a form of revenge porn as well, and it's done by both sexes. People just only get outraged over it when men do it to women, or when other women do it to women. But it gets done to men too, and nobody seems to get outraged over it when it happens to men.
So basically, he did revenge porn, but it was a response to her original, whatever you would call it. Right, somebody called it digital. Digital cucking is what somebody called it, but it was an attempt to really break his heart, or like, you know, put salt on the wound, or whatever you want to call it. And then he
abuse. It was abuse. What she did to him was abuse. She sent him images of her with another man that were the only intent that she had with that was to abuse. That was abuse.
Yeah.
Oh, it was whatever is usually followed by revenging, presumably venging. She venge porned. Why is there no such word as venge? This is bizarre. We need to coin it now.
You can avenge, you can revenge.
Well, this young lady venged. I've made it official.
You can be vengeful.
Someone called it revenge porn jujitsu. Was a revenge porn? he took her energy and then transferred it and turned it against her. So
this is basically like if she threw a boomerang at him and he ducked.
Yeah. And then it hit her.
And now everybody's making her the victim of it.
Yeah.
Because when he ducked, it came back and hit her. You know, or if she threw a grenade at him and he smacked it and it went back at her instead of blowing up on his hand.
Max, you were going to say something?
No, I was just saying that was a good point. Both are pretty much equally responsible in some particular circumstance in regards to this case. It's a terrible thing that happened.
That's all. I mean, I guess if she never tried to do that in the first place, she'd probably still be around. But, I mean, I'm not condoning what he did, but, I mean, what are you going to do? I don't know, would I have done that or not? We could, like, talk about that if we want to in the extended part.
Yeah.
Okay, next story is, Max, you're up. My teen boys are blind to rape culture and all that that includes.
I didn't know you had teen boys, Brian.
That was what? Oh, I see.
Herder.
Sorry, what?
Okay. I see what you did there.
Anyways.
He threw the grenade back at you, is what he did, Brian.
Yeah. Hot potato. Okay, a writer for the Washington Post, Jody Allard, released an article called My Teen Boys Are Blind to Rape Culture. And reading the first couple paragraphs of this article, you begin to understand what it is like to grow up in a household where your mother is a third-wave feminist radical. Allow me to quote some of the complaints that Jody quotes from her sons. Oh boy, not rape culture again. There's no such thing as rape culture. You say everything is about rape culture or sexism. In other words, a daily entry on Honey Badger Radio. Jody begins to ponder what she did wrong to raise two sons that deny rape culture. though she acknowledges that they know the basics of consent and that they would never bring any harm to their partners, she criticizes her sons in a way that we thought would remain exclusive to keyboard warriors. Quote, "My sons who hate hearing about their own privilege nestle inside it like a blanket and accuse me of making up its existence. My sons are part of the problem. Not all men, they remind me, and my guts wrench as my own sons mimic the vitriol of 1,000 online trolls." What Jody doesn't seem to understand is that when you are against the concept of rape culture, it doesn't mean that you are automatically against helping rape victims achieve justice. Jody doesn't seem to understand that while she cites the Brock Turner case, a case where there seems to be genuine proof that he sexually assaulted an unconscious woman, there are men currently outside of his home bearing military armaments that would make Sergeant Kilgore from Apocalypse Now blush. Jody doesn't seem to understand that you can be against paradigms that exacerbate the scope of a problem and still be passionate about helping victims. As it stands right now, I don't see how this type of behavior can be seen as anything other than unconscious child abuse. And finally, before I end just reading this summary, there is a piece of news that I was made aware of after I finished writing this, and it's kind of ironic that I ended my original summary with the words child abuse, because there was a meme, I guess you can say, that was brought to my attention where this particular article was put by side by side with another article that Miss Jody Allard wrote 2 years ago, where she wrote an article titled, "I Knew My Son Was Depressed, But I Didn't Know He Wanted to Die," where she writes about the suicidal tendencies of her son at the time. And then people were beginning to draw comparisons between the way that she was raising her son with these ideals and the way that he was retaliating. So there you go.
Yeah. And I have the article, "I Knew My Son Was Depressed, But I Didn't Know He Wanted to Die," pulled up. So the people who are watching can see it. Let me share it with you guys as well. So
I did stuff. I'm a co-administrator of a meme page called Social Justice Warriors, like, follow, you know the drill. I posted it up there, and just as a commentary, just to describe my feelings on the whole thing, I basically said that I can say from experience that there is a direct correlation between being told that your existence and your beliefs inadvertently condone the subjugation of an entire gender and feeling suicidal. And, you know, if you were to read that comment online and not hear my tone of voice, you might interpret that as a joke, but I assure you it's not, because the same thing happened to me.
Hmm. You're not the only one I've heard that from. Mm-hmm. I have another close friend who, for half of his life, the people around him told me he was a monster, and it was in large part because of his gender. What they basically did was accuse him of something that, if for the same actions, a girl would not have been accused of that, and then they spent, you know, the rest of his childhood, "Well, you're a monster, you're a monster, you're a monster." And when you do that to a person, you know, what do you expect? What do you expect that person to respond with? You know, that it's just, it blows my mind that parents and people who are mentors to children, that they would fail to understand that if, like, these are the same people that, you know, they know you got to give kids positive messages about things, you got to give encouragement, you got to give, not make your criticism hopeless. And, mm-hmm. and yet then they'll turn around when it comes to gender issues, and they have no problem telling boys and men, "You're a monster, you're a monster, you're a monster." Like, that's not going to have an effect. Like, it's different because you're talking about a gender issue? It's not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the effect is that, you know, when you're a kid, like this kid was at the time, I think he was 16, you don't really understand the different nuances of issues in regards to gender. And when you have these messages sort of dictated to you by friends and family or people that you happen to know through work or whatever, and you feel that there's something wrong with it because it's causing you so much self-hatred, yet you can't really explain what it is because of your youthful naivety, it sort of creates this pressure cooker within, because you can't really talk about what's causing you problems. You can potentially allude to it and say, "Well, maybe this whole feminist thing is causing me a lot of distress," and then you have feminists come in and just try to make you feel bad for feeling that particular way. And it just builds up and builds up, and you get to that point where you feel like you're going to explode, much like this kid. Although, you know, that's not unconfirmed. We're just speculating here. But yeah, that's certainly the case for me, and I'm sure the case with the men that Hannah has talked to.
Yeah, we definitely want to come back to this one, because I have some thoughts of my own. So let's go on to the next story. I'll go ahead and not this one. Sorry. All right. Actually, you know what, Scott? Why don't you take this one? Nottingham's catcall hate crime statistics revealed.
Here we go. Since making wolf whistling and catcalling a hate crime in Nottinghamshire, there have been 30 such cases investigated. There were also 19 hate incidents, which are what we call name calling and offensive jokes, offensive towards women, that is. Since policing male behavior has borne such numbers, 15 other UK police forces are looking to follow Nottinghamshire's lead in policing bad male behavior. One expert said that harassment by men is an everyday experience for many. In the UK, it is already illegal to harass people on religion, race, and sexuality. It has recently been altered in Nottinghamshire to include women. Criminologist Loretta Trickett said, "We're not saying all men engage in this behavior, but for some women this has become an everyday experience. A lot of men are not aware of the implications it has on women. Up until now, women have largely not reported this. Women put up with this because it was trivialized in society. People say it's complimentary to be wolf whistled. I think the new recording will give women reassurance that if they call police, their incident won't be registered and they will do something." Nottinghamshire police define misogynistic hate crime as incidents against women that are motivated by an attitude of a man towards a woman and includes behavior targeted towards a woman by men simply because they are women. And I'm the worst talker on the planet.
You got it.
I need to pre-record this for now, I think. Jeez Louise.
So there are 15 other districts, essentially, that are looking to implement similar laws, because Nottinghamshire is actually, I think, how you're supposed to say it, has seen so much success since implementing this hate crime law. So
I'm assuming they're defining success as an increase in people that are put into the jail system.
Essentially. Well, I guess, I don't know that it gets you jail time. I think it gets you fines, but still, I mean...
It sort of makes it sound like this is a business instead of an agency that is dedicated to the protection of the public, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's a new revenue stream for Nottinghamshire.
Yeah, because I mean, if they're not going to jail, then they're paying fines. There's only so many penalties that get used by the state. They jail you if what you do is bad. They fine you if what you do is a little bad. You know, they don't. There's nothing that you do that doesn't involve the state extorting money from you if you get busted for something, basically, if you get arrested for something. You know, even, hell, I don't know if it's the same in Europe, but in the U.S., you don't even have to get arrested. If you get taken in for questioning for certain things, you have to pay, you have to post bail to get out. And I was like,
I wonder if they put you on the sex offenders registry. If they don't, maybe that'll be another change they introduce next year. You whistle on the street and a woman thought you were whistling at her, and boom, you're on the sex offenders registry for the rest of your life. It could happen. You never know.
Yeah.
So, in the course of 5 months, in the county of Nottinghamshire, which according to Wikipedia, you know, take that for whatever you trust it to mean, in 2011, the county had an estimated population of 785,000. And over the course of 5 months, you only get 30 cases.
Mm-hmm.
Are you kidding me?
Well, 30 reports.
Yeah, so how many of them were legit? They've had 2 arrests, I believe, which I think means 28 of them were not legit.
Yeah.
Is this a good use of your time, Nottinghamshire Police?
Yet if it is happening more, then obviously the women that are experiencing this don't think it's really that big of an issue to prosecute the men that are doing it.
In fact, if 28 out of the 30 cases are not legit, the women that think it's a big deal are the ones that it's not happening to.
Well, correction. According to this, the force found that there had been 11 of what they call misogynistic hate crimes, including offenses that include harassment, kidnapping, possession of weapons, and causing public fear, alarm, or distress. And then there were 19 hate incidents that's behavior, such as offensive jokes.
So, wait, kidnapping? Kidnapping is a misogynistic hate crime? I mean, come on, dude. It's already.
I mean, it's already illegal. Yeah.
No. Hey guys, how many women from Nottinghamshire does it take to screw in a light bulb?
How many?
I'm reporting you. That's offensive.
Oh God! You know what? The next thing they're gonna do is they're gonna make mansplaining or manspreading illegal as well.
Well, that's already happened in the U.S. Yeah, manspreading. That's one of the broken window types of arrest. You can get fined and you can actually get ticketed. Yep. Like, you know, you get ticketed for parking in front of a fire hydrant. You can get ticketed for manspreading on the subway.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, like, even the U.S. is more lenient on its what it calls hate crimes than the U.K. I didn't realize that, you know, this was so serious over there. Some of the... We can definitely come back to this one, too. But yeah. Somebody, were you going to say something real quick, or...?
Well, I was just going to say, when you degrade language this way, when you make everything a hate crime... It mm-hmm. really does a disservice to the IQ, I guess, the collective intelligence of our society in general, because when everything is the absolute, like, hate crime, that's something that should be reserved. Like, you know, there are certain things that you use these kind of terminologies mm-hmm. to talk about, because it's not in that same kind of scope. Like, a hate crime is an awful, horrible fucking thing. It's not like... It's like tying somebody to the bumper of a car and killing it and dragging them until they're dead. That's a fucking hate crime.
It has something to do with incitement, right? I mean, if you say something to someone that feasibly could cause other people to attack them, then, yeah, that's some dangerous speech. But, yeah, this is why we call them compliments. When men wolf whistle women or cat call them, there is no situation in which that's going to cause other people to attack them.
Right.
It's not inciting.
There's not like a rape gang is going to come out and go after them or something.
Yeah.
And this is kind of impressive because from what I understand, a lot of counties in the UK tend to be some of the more violent crime-ridden parts of Europe. And the fact that this is how low it is really quite astounding.
Mm.
You know?
Yeah, for sure. All right, let's move on to the next story. We can probably come back to this one a little bit too, because there's some things in here that I'd like to read. All right, some people said that there was an issue with the stream, but it looks like it's back up. It's probably just, for whatever reason, just so you guys know, when we use OBS, the buffering is slower than if I just use Google Hangouts. So it's a little bit of a trade-off, but I'm according to what I have here, everything seems to be up and running fine, and people can see that I'm online. So, but you may run into a little bit of buffering. So if that happens, just back up a little on the play. So, all right. Next story: Trump makes meme magic. Republican presidential candidate Donald J. Trump might not only be trying to become leader of the free world, but also leader of the trolls. He made an announcement that he would speak to the birther controversy and his views on them at a DC conference in September 16th, baiting the press, who seemed only interested in what he would say regarding this. The press eagerly waited to use this as an opportunity to run Trump's campaign to the ground, as the first 20 minutes of the event involved war veterans that are showing support for Trump. Once the time came for Trump to give his thoughts, he gave the shortest speech ever, saying, "Hillary Clinton started the birther rumors in 2008. I finished it. President Barack Obama was born in the United States." An event that would never have gotten airtime, which is this one where the veterans came forward to show support, an event that would never have gotten airtime because the press was hoping to get some dirt on Trump, then got airtime. He may not be as dumb as the media wants us to believe, because they got played. No matter what you might think about the Donald, this much is true. The press got rickrolled, then trolled. What a time to be alive.
Wait a minute, they got rickrolled?
Well, yeah, it's like a rickroll, because Trump said, "I'm going to go to speak on the birther issue." And the press was like, oh shit, it's sort of like when you go and you click on a video that you think you're going to get one thing, and then they go there and he doesn't speak on it at all. Essentially, he just has like a bunch of war vets talk, and that goes on for 20 minutes, and the media, CNN with the 24-hour coverage and all the other places, they're waiting and waiting, and they're talking and they're speculating while all these, like, you know, old vets come up and say words and say a few words, and at the very, very end, he just basically says it really quick. He was born in America, and that's it.
Right, but at what point did he tell Obama that he was never going to give him up and he was never going to let him down?
Oh, well, I figured he was going to say that. That's what I was going to suggest.
A Rickroll is a kind of troll. A Rickroll is a specific kind of troll. That's why they both end in all. It's a little okay. Canon. You should know this.
But I mean, I thought, Max, I was actually thinking that he should have said that for the press, like after he was done. He's like, I just want you guys to know that when I become president, I'm never going to let you down, and I'm never going to give you up. I think that would have been perfect, but
I would have voted it for him if he did that. That's below my standards.
You're Canadian, but yeah.
So
yeah. No, but you all should. Sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Essentially, Trump has invented the stump role. Because that's basically when a politician goes around, you know, talking to people to try to persuade them to vote for him, and schmoozing with groups that he wants to get to vote for him, and so on. That's stumping. You're stumping for your position, and here he got them to cover him stumping.
Mm-hmm.
That's the stump role. He's invented the stump role.
What happened to the Donald Duck meme? The Dolan meme? That would be perfect.
Oh, that would have been perfect, yes.
Dolan, what are you doing? Stop.
You know what?
Bring back the Dolan meme.
You know what else? I just realized he became living clickbait for the press. And this is why I thought, I mean, Allison suggested this story, and at first I didn't want to do it because I didn't really know how it was related to men's rightsy stuff, but when I looked closer, I realized that this is more of an anti-media, or at least something that we can look at to criticize the mainstream media, because that's how this whole show started, was because we talked about Gamergate all the time, and Gamergate is all about the media. So this is just more of that, and that's why I decided to choose this story. But yes, he clickbaited the media. I don't even know what you would call that. But there it is. That's... pretty funny. Okay. Let's see. Let's go on to the next story. I don't know if there's much else to add to that. So, Scott, why don't you tell us how new research establishes that intelligence is inherited from the mother.
Sure you want me to do this?
Why? Oh, because of your reading? Oh, I can do it.
Okay, let's see. According to researchers, their mothers are the principal I'm fucking terrible.
All right, hold on.
I don't know what's going on then.
That's okay. According to researchers, mothers are the principally responsible for transmitting the intelligence genes. At the basis of this idea, there are those known as conditioned genes that behave differently depending on their origin. Basically, these genes have a kind of biochemical tag which allows to trace the origin and reveals even if they are active or not within the progeny cells. Interestingly, some of these affected genes work only if they come from the mother. If that same gene is inherited from the father, it is deactivated. Obviously, other genes work in the opposite fashion, are activated only if they come from the father. We know that intelligence has a hereditary component, but until a few years ago, we thought that much of it depended on the father as well as the mother. However, several studies reveal that children are more likely to inherit intelligence from their mother because intelligence genes are located in chromosome X. This is according to secondnexus.com, by the way. Is this true, or just more data manipulation to suit feminist ideologues? One Vaiti LePrince commented on the article, saying the following: "This is an entirely ridiculous interpretation. Scientists have not found the two intelligence genes, 20,000 to 25,000 genes we have, and use your own intelligence genes to figure out that a girl inherits her other X chromosome from her father. That's how you get an XXX woman. Of course, high IQ moms are also more likely to be better educated and to bond more with their children, which boosts the child's fitness with IQ tests. The confounding socioeconomic and emotional factors are so huge as to reduce your statistical significance to zero here." So, basically, in brief, and I can see, Scott, it was kind of a some of these words were fucked up. I apologize for that. Second Nexus, who took some, there was an article that was shared between them, Cosmopolitan, and a website called psychologyspot.com, tried to state essentially that intelligence is inherited from the mother because it comes from an X chromosome. But the problem with that is that men also have an X chromosome. So they are just wrong about this story. This is just not true. So besides the fact that, just so you guys know, when it comes to intelligence, tests have shown that men and women are on a bell curve when they test for IQ. And the thing that's really interesting about it is that the way that the bell curve shows up for men and women is that there are more men on the extreme ends of both ends of this bell curve. So that means there are more men with lower than average intelligence than women, but there are also more men that with higher than average intelligence than women.
And that's, of course, based only on the standard methods for testing intelligence, which have all been pretty much deemed, you know, necessarily as conclusive as people credit them for being.
Mm-hmm.
Because then there's the other thing is people forget that standardized tests, the best thing that standardized tests measure is how well you take standardized tests. You know, they whatever else they're measuring, it's secondary, you know, compared to how well you take the test. And a lot of intelligence tests only measure certain types of intelligence. They don't really necessarily measure everything about your intelligence. So that's it's possible that that is an accurate representation of human intelligence, and it's also possible that that is a vastly incomplete representation of human intelligence. It's not something that decisions should be made based on, and it's not something that anybody should take offense at, because it's simply a set of numbers, and there's not really any meaning that we can attach to it.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Like, even if this were true, what's the big deal?
Yeah.
Well, and it's like with the bell curve, you know, tests and everything, it's entirely possible that part of the reason that men test at both ends, you know, more extreme at both ends of the IQ spectrum there, is because they are more likely to take risks. So they're more likely to guess on answers instead of not answering. And it may be that the test scores differently that way. You know, there may be a whole range of reasons that aren't necessarily related to intelligence. It might be that there are women are more likely to get nervous because they are taking a test.
Or because,
I know more gals that claim to have test anxiety than I do guys.
And plus, in terms of attention spans, if I'm not mistaken, men tend to have shorter attention spans in comparison to women, where they tend to be a lot more diligent and attracted to a classroom setting. So that, because of that, you might have that dichotomy of, as Milo Yiannopoulos puts it, knuckle draggers and scientists.
Yeah. So it's, I would hate to draw any conclusions. Like the way feminists draw conclusions from stuff like this is bullshit. I'm sure they're probably going to turn around and say fathers don't matter, you know, genetically because of stuff like this or some other such bullshit. And it's something that it's one of the things that really bugs me about feminist research. You know, they look at stuff like this, they start with a conclusion that they want to draw, and they look at stuff like this and they find a way to draw that conclusion, even if it's not really a rational conclusion. So I don't like looking at research on intelligence and drawing any conclusion. It usually, for me, it just inspires more questions.
Yeah, it all started with a conclusion. Which,
yeah.
If this was true, this article, it would mean that it does not matter whatsoever how intelligent the father is. A woman could breed with like a congenital imbecile and still produce a genius. It would mean there is no evolutionary incentive for male intelligence. Mm-hmm. Which would, if it were so, explain why so many women are drawn to utter morons. Maybe that's what they're looking for in this article, an excuse for women to be attracted to violent morons. That's the conclusion that's right. Women are attracted to violent morons. How do we figure out why this is okay?
But that's misogynistic.
Yeah, we'll go along with what Hannah said, though.
Impossible!
You can't take away women's choices. But, you know, there is one other thing I want to add in, too, is that higher IQ women probably have higher IQ children, not only because they're better mothers, probably, but also because they're pickier with the men that they choose to reproduce with. And they probably want someone who is at their level. Most likely, if you have a really smart wife, you have a really smart husband, and they're going to make a really smart baby.
Well, and there's other really smart choices that they might be making as well. They might be more likely to understand more about nutrition. They might be more likely to notice more with respect to healthcare needs. You know, they might be more engaged with their children. You know, there might be a whole set of reasons why their kids might get a better start, but. Like IQ isn't necessarily always genetic either, but no, it's ridiculous to turn around and say that it's inherited.
Yeah, is IQ the best tool we have right now for measuring intelligence?
I think it's pretty much the only widely accepted tool.
Yeah, it's the standardized tool. Yeah.
There is no emotional intelligence quotient test.
No. No, but feminists have tried to create one. Yeah. But I know it's this kind of research, like I said before, this creates more questions than answers. And I can give you another example. There was a controversial thing that came out a while back with respect to races and IQ. And they basically did something similar in that they just looked at numbers. They looked at, they didn't look at anything else in the lives of the people taking the test. And they made all these conclusions about ethnicity and IQ, and then, of course, people started criticizing. And what the critics brought forth was the fact that this type of research, like the critics that, at least the critics that were not the ones who were like, you can't say that because it's racist, we can't talk about this, shut up everybody, you know, but the ones that actually talked about it figured out that, you know, this brings forth more questions than answers. The first one being, all right, if this is happening, if these measurements are accurate, the question becomes why? And it's unreasonable to assume, take one factor in these people's lives and assume that that's it. So it's unreasonable whether you're assuming it's race, it's unreasonable whether you're assuming it's sex, it's unreasonable whether you're assuming it's genetics, it's unreasonable whether you're assuming it's their culture. You know, it could be a lot of different things. It could be their living environment. It could be the opportunities that they've had in their lives. It could be that they hate taking tests. You know, it could be anything. It could be that you picked a bad sample.
Back in the 90s, I remember it was probably around like 97 or 98-ish, there was this study that came out about the eating habits of lower-income people and the effect that it had on their IQs. And there's very compelling evidence to the fact that if children weren't supported nutritionally when they were younger, that they would have lower IQs, that their test scores would be lower, and there was a very strong correlation between those two things. Because it was showing more strongly, well, the idea was that in lower-income families, they didn't have access to the types of foods that a developing brain needed to get the right kind of a nutrition and such, and then that had a long-term effect on the learning potential of the children.
Yeah, cheap food. One of the biggest problems with cheap food is that it doesn't include a lot of protein. And believe it or not, protein is a building block for your brain.
Right.
Mm. In fact, and this is short story time, when I was pregnant, I couldn't keep prenatal vitamins down. None of them. Nothing on the market worked. And I kind of forgot that, for thousands of years, millions of years, women had babies without prenatal vitamins just fine. And panicked and bought a book on nutrition and started reading everything I could and looking for what I needed and everything. And that was one of the things that I learned, was that you need protein during pregnancy to build a brain. You need cholesterol and fat too for it, and you need potassium. And a lot of the foods that contain, aside from potatoes, like potatoes are cheap and they have potassium, but a lot of the foods that it takes to build a brain are not cheap. You know, meat's expensive.
It's why a lot of female vegetarians, once they get pregnant, they start to develop this, what's the word? This,
craving.
This craving for meat. Yeah.
Yeah. And you can't just...
We've got another half generation or so before we see what's really going on in the brains of the children of vegans. Because that's a relatively new movement. And, yeah. You know, what happens when a pregnant woman is a vegan and she stays vegan? There's some dark research that needs to be done there and will be done, probably.
They turn into hipsters.
That's going to be a rough thing because, one of the big differences between the proteins that you get if you're more omnivorous and the proteins that you get if you do not... There's omega-3 fatty acids and omega-6 fatty acids. And if you get one and not the other, you have an imbalance. You know, and it's...
Well, to speak to that particular thing...
Food isn't expensive, it's necessary in the chat. You know, being necessary doesn't make something inexpensive. And that's coming from a household where an emergency surgery happened this year that we're in debt, you know, because of that. So... Yeah, just because something's get cheap, it means it's a priority for spending, but that doesn't necessarily mean you have the ability to obtain it. And, you know, for the people suggesting fish, one of the biggest warnings you get when you're pregnant is not to eat too much fish because of the mercury content. So you can't rely on, and those are omega-3s, those are mostly not omega-6s, so you're still looking at a fat or a fatty acid imbalance there.
Well, there's a way to fix that. There are vegan supplements, and seaweed also is another supplement for that.
If you can take supplements.
Yeah.
All right, well, let's go on to the next story. That was super handy. I did not know all this nutrition stuff. So thank you. Well, that's not entirely true. My girlfriend's always talking about nutrition stuff, specifically the omega-6s and the omega-3 stuff. But anywho, let me go on to the next story, and this will be the last one, but I'm going to do a full reading of the article. We don't have to have an opinion on it. We could. I just wanted to read it. I just got it like just before the show. So this is from spikedonline.com. And is entitled, How I Became a Feminist Victim. Oxford student Eleanor Sharman explains why feminism fails women. Okay. As a female student in a nightclub, I expected to get some unwanted attention. What I didn't expect was for feminism to turn me into someone so terrified of unwanted attention that I stopped going out. In the past, someone groping me would only annoy me for a minute. That would be the extent of it. If they were being really pushy, I'd go to my male friends and stay with them because they'd enjoy making it clear that the guy's attentions were unwelcome. And yes, other men were more likely to listen to my tall, imposing male friends than me, a shy, skinny 18-year-old. You could call it male privilege. I'd call it the benefit of self-confidence. And that was all fine. No harm, no foul. That was until I discovered the now infamous Oxford feminist group Country Living.
Ooh. Oh, no.
It was a big thing in Oxford. Everyone was talking about it, and curious, I joined. I read the posts, I contributed, and I engaged in discussion about everything from rape culture to misogyny in our curriculum. I learned a lot, and slowly, I transitioned from a nervous, desperate-to-please gender egalitarian to a proud, full-blown feminist. Along with all of this, my view of women changed. I stopped thinking about empowerment and started to see women as vulnerable, mistreated victims. I came to see women as physically fragile, delicate, butterfly-like creatures struggling in the cruel net of patriarchy. I began to see male entitlement everywhere. The experience also changed my attitude to going out. I would dress more cautiously and opt to stick with female friends in clubs. And if the usual creep started bothering me, I became positively terrified. I saw them not as drunk men with poor grasp of boundaries, and certainly not as misguided optimists who might have misread my behavior, but as aggressive, probable rapists. If I was groped by someone, I didn't give them a scathing look or slap away their hand, and I certainly didn't tell them to fuck off. Instead, I was scared into inaction. How could I countenance such a violation? How could I possibly process something so awful? After the event, I would go outside and cry, and then I would leave feeling traumatized. I saw the incident not as some idiot being a bit too handsy, but as sexual assault, something scarring to dwell upon. It was something to whisper to small friends, or I'm sorry, to friends in a small hushed voice. Something to preface with a trigger warning, and the appropriate action of friends upon hearing this was never to question how upsetting the incident had really been. It was to sympathize, express shock and horror, and say things like, "I don't know how you coped." Not support, but pity. Anything else would be tantamount to victim blaming. Any suggestion that such incidents weren't really that big a deal and shouldn't be treated as trauma was repellent to me. Victim feminism taught me to see my body as inviolable. Any action visited upon it was violence. Eventually, I stopped going out. It wasn't worth the risk. It took me a long time to realize what had happened. Feminism had not empowered me to take on the world. It had not made me stronger, fiercer, or tougher. Irony of ironies, it had turned me into someone who wore long skirts and stayed at home with their girlfriends. Even leaving the house became a minefield. What if a man whistled at me? What if someone looked me up and down? How was I supposed to deal with that? This fear-mongering had turned me into a timid, stay-at-home, emotionally fragile bore. Thankfully, I learned a lot from the experience. Teaching women that we exist as probable victims to the probable attacks of men is not freeing or empowering. Modern feminism trains us to see sexism and victimhood in everything. It makes us weaker. It is also anathema to gender equality. How are we to reconcile with our male oppressors when we view them as primitive, aggressive beasts? How are we to advance female agency when everything from dancing to dating is deemed traumatic? The answer to the problems we face as women is not to submit to the embrace of victim feminism, but to stand up for ourselves. We must throw off the soft, damp blanket of safe space culture and face the world bravely. If we do not do so now, we will consign any prospect of real equality to the ash heap of history.
She just can't get laid. Yeah, it's obvious from you. She's just a fucking neckbeard and she can't get laid and she should get privileged.
I would love to find out from her exactly what snapped her out of the fear-mongering mindset.
I'm gonna reach out to her, actually, and see if she wants to come on the show sometime.
Yeah,
that'd be interesting. Although I would say she may not realize it, but she was a feminist victim from the beginning. She was a feminist victim before the whole thing started. If she, before she joined that group, before feminism got its ugly hooks into her, if she went places expecting to get unwanted attention, if that was her expectation, I'm going to a nightclub and I'm going to get unwanted attention, that's already a fearful mindset. And like, it's been a few years, I will admit that. Like, back in the 80s, though, I did used to go out with friends to nightclubs and dance, more bars than anything, because my area is not that sophisticated. It never would have dawned on me to think, I'm going to go in there and get unwanted attention. You know, no, it was, I'm going to go in there and have a damn good time with my friends. And some of them are going to drink, and I'm going to get my drinks paid for because I'm drinking pop and I'm the designated driver. So all I got to do is go in and dance. This is great. You know, and that was it. That was what was on my mind. And if I happened to meet somebody, I met somebody. And if I didn't meet somebody, I didn't meet somebody. But the idea that I was going to have to deal with unwanted attention and that it was going to be a big deal for me if I did, never was on my mind when I went out to those places. Hell, half the reason you go there is to get somebody else's attention, make a connection, and maybe make a friend, you know, or find somebody to date. It just, what a mindset.
So, Hannah, it was all around her? It was already there beforehand?
Yes, it was all around her.
Would you say that she was born in it?
Yes, absolutely.
I was going to say, you know, it surrounds us, it penetrates us.
Oh, God.
Penetrates us. I knew that was coming.
It's an energy field. It surrounds us, it contains in all living things. All right.
Wait, what's that from? You just sounded like John Lovitz there.
No, I wasn't trying to be John Lovitz. So.
It penetrates all of us.
That just makes it sound even better.
Yeah, that's
it. It surrounds us all, Hannah.
But it just blows. We've gotten to this point where that's what girls think about when they go out for a good time with their buddies. They don't think about what they're going to do. They don't think about what they're going to go, where they're going to go. They don't, you know, have plans on, you know, who they're going to meet or what they're going to get, if they're going to go shopping or what. No, it's, am I going to get looked at by a man? Oh my God.
This article is undeniable, irrefutable proof that feminism has evolved to a movement that is not at all for trying to improve women's self-esteem. It's not to empower them to be able to go beyond limits that they set for themselves or what society sets for them. It's just to make them feel like they're the victim of everything and build their entire identity around that.
Yeah, a pivotal line in this article is, what if a man whistled at me? What if someone looked me up and down? How was I supposed to deal with that? Well, you got two choices. Either you can deal with it like this lady and be better than the fear-mongering, or you can make it illegal for men to do those things. And it's pretty much confirmed at this point that the feminist answer is to make it illegal for men to whistle mm-hmm. and to look at women up or down or both or neither.
I'm starting to get this sense of feminism as a, you know, an entity in a trench coat in a dark alley, like signaling people to come over, come here, you know, try out a couple of these panic attacks. First one's free.
You know, I think it's even more nefarious than that, honestly. It's more of a protection racket than anything else. Like, well, you better follow the feminism, and we might have to do something like, you know, make whistling at people illegal, you know.
Nah. Well, you got both going on there, because they're in college campuses, in women's studies classes, and even in their counseling now that they get during orientation, pulling that shit, first panic attacks free, on all the girls, and telling them that the guys are there to mac on them, and it's something horrible and evil and dangerous, and they should be afraid of it. And then at the other end of it, they're threatening legal changes. They're threatening businesses. Oh, you got to have this many women, even if they're not qualified, or we're going to call you sexist. You want to give some money to our foundation so that we don't have to come out against you? You know, it really is a big scam. It's like a combination of being drug dealers and being a mafia protection racket.
Yeah, and feminists couldn't get any laws passed if it wasn't for an army of white knights that are willing to do that for them. So you have to consider that too. Like, you know, they got this law passed in Nottinghamshire, and they're gonna do it, and they're talking about doing it in 15 other places. So this young lady who apparently goes to Oxford probably lives up there, and she's going to see this firsthand. But that couldn't, those things couldn't be enforced if it weren't for men. So that is another part of it too. Just something to consider, you know. But all right, well anyway, that's all the, what go ahead.
Quick question, I just wanted to ask. Eleanor Sharman, is that her, the picture of the woman that
no,
looks like,
I, that looks like it's just stock photography. I don't know.
Damn it. So.
It does have the quality of a stock photo.
Yeah. Yeah, I was just gonna say, too bad.
Yeah, never mind. I'll look her up. I see. You like them scared, don't you, Max? You like it when they look like that. Okay.
Is there another way to have it?
That's not scared. That's coy. I can read that expression.
Yes.
That's a come to bed coy.
Yes. beneath those terrified eyes, what that those hands are covering is a gleeful smile.
Yes, exactly.
My girlfriend has taught me anything. But anyways, go ahead, Brian.
All right. Well, now we're done looking at the individual stories, so let's go back and do maybe a little bit of discussion. Does anybody want to say anything about the yes. Tiziana Cantone case?
I do. I was noticing when I was poorly reading this thing that people were talking about, you know, have some sympathy. And I don't want to come off as not being sympathetic to what happened with this case, because that was not my intention. But, you know, the realist in me is like, is screaming, this woman kind of did this to herself. It sucks.
That's what ultimately suicide is, isn't it?
Well, yeah, I mean, that was kind of what I was getting at. It's just like, you know, she created the situation whereby all these events were brought into play. You know, she was being vindictive and spiteful, and it eventually came back to bite her. You know, so it's like, while I have sympathy and I understand the idea of, you know, being suicidal or wanting to kill yourself because I honestly don't remember a day in my life that I probably haven't felt suicidal. It's something I've struggled with for the last fucking as many years as I've been aware that I've been alive and existing. So I understand that, and I don't want to make light of that, because this is horrible. But she, I hate saying it because it sounds so callous, but she brought this on herself. She was of her own demise.
Yeah.
And, you know, it sucks, but it is the reality of the situation. So, yeah.
I'd like to throw in something that they didn't seem to discuss. I wonder if, I mean, I don't know that it's too much of a wonder, but since there's no, I don't really have the facts on it, I'm going to say wonder for lack of a better term. I wonder if Tiziana Cantoni had a history of psychological issues, because to make a sex tape to spite your husband is it's a little bit out there. Like, I mean, yeah, it happens, but it's a little bit out there, and it seems really extreme. You know, to something to do that you would be so vindictive that you would want to make a tape to essentially psychologically and emotionally abuse someone that you were married to. And then on top of that, to respond with what happened when it turned out that what you attempted to do backfired, you find that the next step, the there was so much shame and embarrassment from it that you take your own life. That speaks to, I think she had problems. That doesn't sound sane.
Yeah, that's not normal behavior.
That's not normal behavior at all.
And not the slightest.
You know, and I'm not trying to laugh because I'm not laughing at her. I'm just, you know, this is an uncomfortable kind of laugh because it is clearly she has issues. And
the tragedy of the situation just causes you to respond in such a befuddled way because you can't help but just, like, you know, have that laughing like what you just had, Brian.
Yeah.
Well, what this basically is, if you take the details of what the things and what the steps involved were, is this woman set up a threat narrative, and then it backfired against her, and then she responded to it backfiring by killing herself.
Mm-hmm.
Like she sent this tape. She didn't publish the tape, did she?
No,
she was the one who put it out there. Initially.
She is the one who put it out there. And well, I mean, she was trying to blame him?
She gave it to people and then it was then disseminated otherwise.
Okay.
So she started the chain of events that led to it being put out there.
But she made this specifically to hurt this guy. This kind of sounds like a Darvo attack.
Kinda,
essentially, yeah. Deny, accuse, reverse victim and offender.
Yeah.
You know, where she's basically denying that she's done anything to cause this problem, you know, that it's his fault or other people's fault that something that she shared became
right.
public.
Right.
And now they're getting accused and she's treating herself as she's being treated as a victim. And the way that she got treated as a victim was by killing herself. You know, and this is going to be a real sore topic for me today. Because I'm right now waiting to hear back from a friend in crisis, and I don't want to sound callous, but I have a lot less sympathy for someone who, you know, they basically threw something and it bounced back and hit them, and they threw it with intent to hurt and humiliate. They threw it with intent to do to the person they threw it at what they ended up experiencing, and it bounced back and hit them. I feel a lot less sympathy for that than I would if she were in a situation where, you know, something had happened to her and she had not had any part in it. And I hate to say this, but, you know, mm-hmm. every example that we run across in the men's movement where our attention is drawn to a man who has killed himself, it's been because of something horrible. His kids are taken away. He's been wrongfully accused and he's afraid he's going to go to jail, or, you know, his reputation has been ruined. Men who have killed themselves, men and boys who have killed themselves even after being exonerated because the accusation is so bad. Men and boys who have been made homeless because of draconian child support obligations. And then you get this woman who's act of abuse against another person didn't go the way she wanted it to, and people found out about it, and she was embarrassed, and she killed herself. And it just kind of pisses me off, because these other guys, you see media reports about their situations, and you see people talking about them online, and people come out in droves to condemn their actions. How dare they kill themselves in their terrible circumstances? They did it just to hurt the people in their lives. They did it just to get revenge, whatever. Here's somebody who basically did. She did it just to hurt the people in her life. She did it just to get revenge. Not one of those feminists that were out there condemning the guy that set himself on fire in front of the courthouse because he lost his family are speaking up about this woman. Not one of the feminists that tried to silence the suicide note. I recently retweeted Judgy Bitch's reading of it to a suicide prevention hashtag. Not one of the feminists that condemned A Voice for Men for publishing that suicide note is out there saying, well, no, this woman's not a victim. You know, none of them. Because she's a woman. Mm-hmm. And the only reason that they don't have sympathy for those men is because they're men. And the only reason that they can't take a rational look at this woman's actions is because she's a woman.
Well, I can take another angle there. This woman died because she, whatever else was going on in her head, she died because she couldn't handle the fame. And what brought her the fame in this case was the internet. So it's no surprise that, you know, we can read in the caption of this article, Tiziana Cantoni's suicide prompts calls for internet privacy overhaul. And it's The Independent saying this, which makes you think, how many deaths, or how many suicides have been as a result of people who can't handle the fame? But because it wasn't the internet responsible, it was papers like The Independent, you have to wonder how many people over the decades have killed themselves because of, you know, fame they couldn't handle that they got from the establishment press. But of course, the establishment press doesn't cover those particular suicides because it doesn't want to look as culpable as it clearly is. But if someone died because of internet fame, well, we're right on it. I wonder, establishment media, how much fucking blood is on your hands.
That's a good point. I'm reminded of Kurt Cobain when you said that. But, yeah. So, anybody have any other thoughts about Tiziana Cantoni, or should we move on to this horrible fucking mother who treated her son so shittily?
Well, I got one other thing to say.
Okay.
And this is basically to anyone who hears this who has contemplated suicide. And that is it. And no matter how bad it gets, and no matter what situation you're in, you know, there is always going to be somebody who wishes that you had contacted them and talked to them first. And you probably know who that person is in your life. So this is my request. When you're there, and when you're ready, and you think you're going to do it, contact that person. Do them one favor and do yourself one favor and give them time to respond.
Can I also, that's wonderful, Hannah. I was just also going to ask if I could quote something very quickly in regards to the whole situation.
Do it.
Yeah. Because Brian, you brought up Kurt Cobain, and I just wanted to quote another musician, my number one hero that came out during that time, Billy Corgan of the Smashing Pumpkins, when he was speaking about the same issue. He said something along the lines of every time that he's ever thought about killing himself, which apparently was multiple times throughout his life, he said that if he was able to see what was going to come later in his life, like if he could look inside a magic crystal ball and see what was going to be in store for his life, there's no way he would ever consider it. Life is so full of sublime, beautiful moments that to think that you're making a call that really shouldn't be yours to make. You're telling yourself that this is the only option, and it's a shame that you have to be all by yourself and brood and spin when there are people that are, like Hannah said, ready to lift you up. So please contact that person.
Mm-hmm. Billy Corgan's a cool dude, man.
Yeah.
He also has he don't like SJWs either.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you, Max, for sharing that. Let's go on to the next story. So this one, it really bothers me. This is the woman, Jolie Allard, who basically wrote a couple pieces such as, "I knew my son was depressed, but I didn't know he wanted to die," as well as, "My teen boys are blind to rape culture," and how upset she is. And I just wanted to throw some... I know that basically we covered this, but there was a line, something that she said that just really blows my mind. It's when she says, "My sons, who hate hearing about their own privilege, nestle inside it like a blanket and accuse me of making up its existence. My sons are part of the problem." Now, I think it's bad enough that when you're a boy and you are growing up in a school system and an education system that already doesn't know how to deal with you or how to properly educate you because it's not concerned with giving boys priority, and it's instead mostly raises them like dysfunctional girls. And then those boys grow up and they go to learn, sex education in high school and in middle school, and they learn about how terrible they are, not only historically, because they usually do this thing like throughout history men have always been, they ruled everything and women were under their thumbs and they're the fault for all the wars and all the deaths and the Inquisition and the Crusades and all this shit. And you learn about, women's lib and all the stuff that's essentially put on men from the beginning of time as a boy. Then you go into college and the first thing you have to take are consent classes, because otherwise you might just lose your shit and go raping women. And you have to be told not to do that. This is all just standard stuff. Like when I went to my college, every quarter, they would do this thing with the new students, and they would tell them things like, "1/3 of you would rape a girl if you thought you could get away with it." It was based on this really shitty study that they did a while back, and which we've already discussed on previous shows. So you have to deal with all that stuff. But at the very least, for most boys, at the very least, they have reprieve with their mother. At the very least, they may have that. And because they say, this as the saying goes, mother is God in the eyes of a child. So when your own mother is telling you that you're part of the problem and you're part of rape culture and that she's disappointed because you don't see your own privilege, how can you be surprised that your boys are depressed to the point where they're feeling suicidal? Their own mother hates them for their gender. She won't say it in plain English, in plain words, but it is in all of her writing and the way that she approaches dealing with her boys. It's like she wishes she never had them. Because if she had girls, she wouldn't be writing these pieces. At least not like pieces like my teen girls are blind to rape culture.
Oh, and you know what, too? Here's that adds another wrinkle, Brian, in that the man is responsible for the sex of the children, so she probably hates her husband for giving her boys and not girls.
Well, we're not hearing much about the husband in the situation. I have a feeling that there may be like a divorce or a split or something. But I don't know. Yeah.
You're right. This is a pretty horrible way to raise your children with basically the sins of the father kind of scenario where these boys are guilty of all these things without ever having lived at this point. I mean, she's talking about her 16-year-old son and all these other things and like you're saying, like kind of placing this onus on them for things that other people have done or what she perceives to be, as it were. And Yeah, it's pretty horrible. It's a pretty bad weight to have to carry for a child, basically.
Well, I think one of the most telling sections of the article, one about rape culture, here it is. When it comes to speaking out against rape culture and questioning their own ideas and behavior, they become angry and defensive. Not all men, they remind me, and my guts wrench as my own sons mimic the vitriol of 1,000 online trolls. No matter how often my sons remind me that they are good men, they don't understand that being good is an action. Okay. Your sons are not dogs, all right? You're supposed to believe they're good as soon as they pop out of you there. Dogs are those things that you make do tricks, you make them behave, and then you say, good boy, okay? Dogs are supposed to be conditionally good boys, okay? And it's interesting that when they become angry and defensive, that's not an action, is it, Jody? That's just natural boyhood, isn't it? It's the default for boys to be angry and defensive, but they have to perform actions before they can be good. They have to perform the exact correct actions that you and your feminist posse want them to perform before you will consider that glob of flesh that popped out of you as good. Fuck you to 17 kinds of hell, you cunt.
Mm-hmm. You guys remember, Brian, I'll ask you because I don't know if everybody else is old enough to have watched it, but you remember a TV show called Archie Bunker? All in the Family.
Not All in the Family.
Archie Bunker, but a character named Archie Bunker.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And he would go off sometimes on these rants that were just absolutely ignorant. And, I mean, there were a lot of lessons in that show. The show was basically created as a way to get people to think.
It was also a Bridge the Generations.
Yeah, Bridge the Generations. Because you had the Free Love Generation, and then you had the generation that sort of was, just before the baby boomers. And everybody was, always coming down on Bunker because he would say these horrible things. And the thing that I have always thought of with that, I don't know if every family has this, but I know a lot of families do. And in my family, in my extended family, not my household, there's a family member that had a particular prejudice, that no matter what the topic of conversation when he was around, he would always turn it to that. And, he always had the folks of that particular prejudice had their own language surrounding that particular prejudice, using specific names for the people against whom they were prejudiced and everything else. Essentially slurs, and a lot of more technical sounding slurs, And it gets very wearing on you when you're around a person and all they do is go off on a particular group against whom they are prejudiced. And that's not only the only thing they'll talk about, but if you don't agree with them, you're the one who's prejudiced, you're the bigot, you're the bad guy, and you're supporting dysfunction. And I grew up not directly affected by that all the time. It was something that I noticed, and we in the extended family would shake it off and kind of laugh about it, and it was funny, and he was our Archie Bunker. But imagine being in the group that the individual was prejudiced against and having to hear it all the time. Imagine being not only in that group and having to hear that all the time because the person lives with you, but the person doing it to you is of the relationship to you that is so fundamentally and profoundly human-forming, basically, that popular culture has all kinds of examples of comparing it to godhood. Your own mother tells you you're a monster. Your own mother tells you that you're fundamentally flawed because of your gender.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's it's not just abuse. It's beyond ordinary abuse. It's like the difference between calling, hitting somebody and leaving a bruise abuse and cutting their legs off or stabbing them in the spleen. Now, these guys growing up with this, I mean, she's essentially stabbed them over and over again in the psyche.
Oh, yeah. By the way, Jodi Allard, the woman who wrote this article, she is a former techie turned freelance writer living in Seattle. She writes primarily about parenting, women's issues, and life with a chronic illness. She writes about parenting primarily. This woman gives parenting advice.
I'm curious what chronic issue or what chronic illness she's living with.
Feminism.
I'm starting
feminism.
To wonder. Well, no.
She's two middle children. She's that's her chronic.
Her chronic illness. I wonder if she's borderline. Because this is the type of abuse that someone with borderline personality disorder heaps on the people around them.
Oh, I can try to find out. Follow Sen Vodka. It's her name. Sen Vodka. So, alcoholism?
Sen...
Her Twitter handle is Sen Vodka.
Jeez, that would be so horribly perfect. An alcoholic mother psychologically abusing her children and writing about it online for her career.
Yeah.
Jeez.
Why does this seem so familiar?
I hope it's not Banker's Vodka. Because bankers is a sexist term. Thanks to the commenters in my last video for pointing out that bankers is a kind of vodka and not a fucking hell.
Tony8353 says, that's like Liz Taylor giving advice about marriage. And yep, that is that's quite an observation. Nella B says, or bipolar, and that's a distinct possibility because there's some overlap in the symptoms and the behavioral, aspects of it.
I'm not finding anything right now, but I can try later on.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to. Yeah, it's kind of hard to track stuff like that down if that's not the thing that she writes about the most.
Mm-hmm.
But I would wonder, and if we find out that that's the case, if we find out she's got something else, like she writes about living with diabetes, that's a totally different thing. But if she's writing about living with a mental illness and then she's getting all high and mighty at her teenagers and writing about that online, this woman needs to be shamed.
Mm-hmm. She said chronic illness, to be fair, which could be something physical.
Yeah, it could be something physical.
Yeah. We can come back.
And if it's borderline, then she's very unlikely to even come to terms with the fact that she's got it. I mean, that's one of the symptoms of borderline.
Yeah.
They'll pretend they have everything except borderline, which again, makes sense.
Yeah. Well, or that there's nothing at all. Everybody else has a problem. I'm fine, but everybody else around me is bipolar. But given what she's revealed about herself there, and the situation that she's alerting the world to with that article, it isn't a big surprise that one of her sons, at some point was suicidal. If she's telling the truth about that, and good God, writing about that, I cannot imagine being that kid. And having gone through that crisis and have my mother go online and tell the world about it.
She was diagnosed with mitochondrial disease, a rare genetic disorder that impacts energy production in every cell of the body except for red blood cells. Simply put, her body struggles to produce enough energy to meet its needs, and the impact of these energy shortages can be felt in every system of the body. There is no treatment for mitochondrial disease. All that can be done is to treat the symptoms and wait for the science to catch up.
Well, that's not borderline, but no. It doesn't mean that she's not. It just means that's not the one that she's writing about.
Mm-hmm.
Well, at least not when she's saying she's writing about a medical disorder. When she writes about parenting, that's when she's writing about being borderline.
Dear feminists, please do not prey on the chronically ill. They are extra vulnerable to your bullshit.
Yes. So, you know what this is kind of like, and maybe it's a bit of a stretch, maybe I'm misunderstanding it a little bit, but it almost seems like she's using her children as kind of like a proxy, almost like in a Munchausen's kind of way.
Yeah.
You know, it seems sort of like that.
All right.
No, that's a characteristic of feminism as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. And in fact, they do it to women at large, you know, or women as a group. I wouldn't be surprised if they do it to their kids too.
Right.
Okay, so does anyone want to add any other thoughts on the Nottinghamshire story about the hate crime? I know we did talk about it a bit, but I wanted to give anybody any opportunity to make any other commentary about it.
I'll just kick it off with a "I told you so." It's like now there's 15 other you know provinces or whatever that are looking to do this kind of stuff.
But lads, you need to start chatting up women more often. Remember that article we just read last week? I think it was. You guys gotta just suck it up, stiff upper lip and all that. Approach a woman and chat her up, because there are women that are becoming lonely because they're not getting chatted up. Just don't get arrested while you're doing it. So you got to chat them up the right way.
You're a loser. It's down to the two things now. If you try to get laid, it's rape culture. If you don't try to get laid, it's loser culture. Take your pick, men.
There you go.
Yes. And now I wonder why so many guys are going their own way. But we're all shaming them too, because fuck them. We don't want to understand why. We just want to be upset that they're not manning up and taking a more masculine job and like chasing down skirts and all that.
Don't call them skirts. That's sexist, Brian.
I was talking about shopping, chasing down kilts. Maybe some men want to chase down kilts.
There you go.
Okay. Somebody in the comments section said, "Guys, Angelina Jolie and Brad Pitt are divorcing." Yeah, I saw that. Oh, I think it was a non-story.
Yeah.
Okay, whatever. Isn't like Brad Pitt with Marianne Cotillard now or something like that? Well, it doesn't matter.
Hey guys, what do you get if you cross an elephant and a rhino?
What do you get?
A hell if I know. That's my response to all things about celebrity couples. Yeah. Unless, you know, Jolie goes after Brad Pitt for child support and alimony and stuff like that. I don't care if they break up. I didn't care when they got together. I hated going to the grocery store and seeing splashed all over the publications around the checkout counter the huge drama surrounding the who was it that he broke up with to be with her? Jennifer Aniston. And that's like the extent that I know of it is what was in the headlines. And it just like, do I really have to see this? I'm going to like just look at the floor all the way up to the actual checkout, and then I don't have to deal with it. Because it's stupid. Who cares? It's just a group of people. What is it, still high school where we have to watch, you know, what the quarterback and the head cheerleader are doing, and we get all excited if the quarterback breaks up with the head cheerleader to go with the head of the pep squad, you know. It's just big deal.
Hannah, you're doing on the Lord's work. I applaud you.
Yeah, really. I don't really
thank
care.
You.
I don't really care about the affairs of gajillionaires, yeah. Unless of course someone's trying to screw them over, like what happened with Johnny Depp.
The saying about talking about people and talking about ideas? I forget how.
Yeah,
forget
it's like small minds. Well,
yeah, small great minds talk about people.
Great minds
talk about ideas.
Yeah, great minds talk about ideas. Average minds talk about events, and small minds talk about people.
Yeah.
Eleanor Roosevelt said that.
My interest in it would strictly be limited to if a men's issue comes up. You know, aside from that, I really don't care.
Yeah,
I don't want to know. I had to have other people explain to me a couple of years ago when they got their show and they hit the big time and all that, who the hell the Kardashians were. I still don't understand why they're famous.
They're famous for being famous. But first, yeah. It was because one of them leaked a sex tape, and she was friends with a girl who also leaked a sex tape. You remember, it all began with what's her name?
Paris Hilton.
Paris Hilton.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then like Kim Kardashian traveled in the same circles as Paris Hilton, and then But I don't know. This is already making my
Paris Hilton's famous either.
For a sex tape.
She has a lot of money.
Yeah.
She has a lot of money.
But there's other people whose parents are rich that like nobody knows who they are. They stay out of the.
Well, they didn't make a sex tape.
It's the sex tape.
Yeah, I suppose.
And it was also on the heels of like that show she did with what's her name, Lionel Richie's daughter, where they were like, oh, rich girls, you know, debutantes, go to the farm and try to live like regular people. And
oh, good
I didn't
grief.
Watch that shit. But it was like shortly. It's all about the timing and. All this stuff is just, I think it's sort of manufactured.
It's not about how rich you are, it's about whether or not you have an agent. I mean, some rich kids just simply go to Hollywood or whatever and get some help from PR. And once PR's involved, yeah, it's their job to make you famous.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, you just leave it up to them.
Okay.
And they take it away. And say, but who's responsible, by the way, for all this gossip media? Who do we blame? For newspapers being all about fucking celebrities.
The
it's
media?
Well established that men are into hard sciences and all that abstract
stuff.
The
consumers that are buying
into people and talking about people and stuff. So do we blame toxic masculinity for the state of newspapers?
Yeah, because we all know when it comes to gossip. Yes. When it comes to gossip, actually, men are right in the middle. They want all the juicy gossip.
Yeah, you know, actually, that sort of brings up something that I've had to say repeatedly regarding the election and Hillary Clinton and the questions that she gets asked and everything. Feminists regularly bitch that women who run for office are not taken seriously because Hillary Clinton gets asked questions about her clothes and her hair. But it's not Newsweek asking her those questions. It's not Time Magazine. It's not Business Weekly. It's not Forbes. None of these reporters that work for these, you know, news magazines are asking Hillary Clinton about her hair and her clothes. It's the women's magazines. It's the women reporters that are pandering to the female voter that wants to hear about Hillary's hair and her clothes. And if women didn't want that, nobody would report it because men don't give a rat's ass. In fact, I will bet you Hillary could change her hairstyle 15 times in 2 weeks and not a single man would notice. They'd be too busy paying attention to what she said and whether it would and why.
You know,
and how many times she coughed, but
how many times and whether or not she passed out on the way to the car.
Look, she's dying.
There would be some men that would be watching frame by frame to see if there's a moment where a shadow is cast over her eyes because they're closed, you know, just enough, and they'd be like, "See, she's one of the lizard people. She's one of the lizard people."
There's
nothing about distraction.
Nothing whatsoever about hairstyle
issues.
They're just trying to break the conditioning, Hannah.
There you go.
I think that people would probably have questions about her clothes if she also decided to shave her head and get a Persian to go with it. but anyway,
you can see my face right now, Brian.
Yes, I think well, I know.
I feel about that comment.
I'm not like a Brazilian.
I mean, a Persian. You know what? Never mind. Let's
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so there's nothing else. I think we should just close out because I think we've pretty much run roughshod over these topics, and it is 6:29, so we're gonna wrap it up. Does anybody have any? I think does anybody have any final thoughts or things they want to shill or anything like that before I just say goodbye?
You know, there's one thing I wanted to say real quick about the Jody Allard was talking about her kids.
Fame they couldn't handle that they got from the establishment press.
And it's like,
but of course,
these are kids, you know. If they're born or they're raised in an environment where they're told there's a rape culture all the time, so they're keenly aware to it, to the potential of it. And then they go around and they live their lives and they don't ever see it. Then, you know what, I'm inclined to kind of agree with them that they, you know, that there probably isn't one. Yeah, you know, because, like, if kids can see there isn't one, then there probably isn't one. You know, I mean, obviously there isn't one, but, I mean, it's just like, you know, it's like when you've been made aware of these things and you're looking for the boogeyman, the boogeyman's not there, then maybe it's not there, you know? From the mouth of babes comes wisdom or whatever the fuck it is. But, yeah, anyway, there's that.
Yeah.
Well, we just need to start pointing out to feminists that rape culture is a feminist social construct. because they've basically based it on a definition of rape and a claim about its prevalence that excludes female perpetration against men. And so they've treated it as something that happens only to women, and it happens to women a lot, and all men are guilty of it and all that stuff. They completely ignore the fact that in all of the statistics gathering methods that feminists have done, if you ask men the same questions that you ask women and you ask them the same way, you get the same percentage of yes answers. And if you ask women the same questions that you ask men when you're trying to gather statistics on perpetrators and perpetration, you get the same questions as well, or same answers as well. And the question that leads to is rape culture based on reality, or is it strictly based on feminism's definitions and methodology?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, thank you, Hannah. I'm going to go ahead and wrap up the show. So I want to thank my panelists for coming on, and I want to thank you guys for listening to the stream. Please leave us comments related to any of the topics that we discussed. If you were having problems with the stream, if you wanted to watch it on the playback, it should be smooth all the way through. That happened last week when we ran into lots of technical issues for whatever reason. But when you go back and listen back to the stream, other than a little bit of some BS in the beginning, everything was really nice. I don't get it. Maybe it's Google. I don't know. So we're going to wrap it up. Yes, Allison, I'm wrapping it up now. Please leave a comment, and I'll talk to you guys next time on the Polecat Cast. Have a good evening. No, I'm not sure.